Yeah, in the last class, we discussed the forward converter. The transformer which is used in forward converter requires three windings, two for energy transfer and the third one for continuity of flux. So in our analysis, we connected the third winding to the supply, to VDC. It is not an essential condition that we need to connect the third winding to VDC. Instead, we can have a flyback converter between primary and the tertiary winding. Okay. Similar to flyback converter, if you have more number of secondaries, you can have multiple outputs. So even in forward converter, multiple outputs are possible. Okay. Now coming to the third winding, the tertiary winding, we selected the number of turns to be same as the primary, N3 is equal to N1. If that is the case, the cross-sectional area of the conductor that is used for the tertiary winding should be very small, because tertiary winding carries only the magnetizing current. Okay. So number of turns in the primary as well as tertiary is the same, but then cross-sectional area of the primary depends on the secondary current also, because primary carries the magnetizing current as well as the equivalent secondary current, whereas the tertiary winding just carries the magnetizing current. So you can use a very thin conductor for the tertiary winding, and the primary conductor depends on the secondary current. So if the number of turns is the same, the maximum value of D can be 0.5. So if you go above 0.5, the flux will be continuous, and it will so happen that it may saturate the core. So D max is 0.5. Okay. So we discussed about the flyback as well as forward converters. Both converters operate in the first quadrant. H is either positive or 0. We are not applying the negative ampere turns or H. So before going into other power supplies, I will solve a problem in forward converter as well as a flyback converter. Okay. So first one is on flyback converter. The problem states that, see, required output voltage is 100 volts, okay, and nominal input is 12 volts. Input is 12 volts, okay. So the problem says find the turns ratio such that output voltage required is 100 volts at D is equal to 0.5. So generally the nominal value of D is around 0.5, even for flyback as well as the forward converters, okay. At 0.5 for a nominal input voltage of 12 volts. See, input is 12, okay, and output voltage is 100 volts. Now, see, we are applying 12 volts to the primary. There is a device, a non-ideal device, when it is conducting, even if it operates in saturation, voltage drop across it will be approximately 2 volts or so, depends again. So maximum voltage that is applied to the winding is of the order of 10, and that winding has its own resistance again. Okay. So maximum voltage that is applied to the winding is less than 10, and output is 100. So ratio of 10, the boost output by input is ratio is of the order of 10. So it would be extremely difficult if I don't use a transformer. If I just use a boost converter, it would be extremely difficult to get a ratio of 10, in just because we found in Boost as well as BuckBoost, it's a strong function of the ratio of the load resistance to the inductor winding resistance. Okay. And part A, compute the minimum and maximum values of D if input varies from 10 to 14 volts. Okay. Keep V naught constant. Problem. So input itself is varying from 10 to 14. Output should be regulated at 100 volts. Therefore, as the input changes, we need to change the duty cycle. So that's why I said a closed loop control is a must. One reason is that if the load gets disconnected, now I'm storing the energy, dumping it to the output, capacitor voltage goes on building up. And for second reason, in order to maintain a constant output voltage, we need to have a closed loop control. We need to have a closed loop control. Okay. Now, part B of the problem, compute the value of LS. LS is the secondary inductance or inductance of the secondary, so that I2 is just continuous at the minimum value of D. Okay. So first we need to find out the minimum value of D, and for that value I2 should be just continuous. And the part C, it says find the value of C for output voltage ripple of 1% at D is equal to D max. Okay. So we need to find out the output voltage ripple, or we need to regulate the output voltage at 1% for maximum value of D. Again, we need to find out the maximum value of D. Nominal is 0.5. So when we need to have minimum D and when we should have maximum D, when the input is varying from 10 to 14, we'll find out. See, again, it is a non-ideal converter in every sense. Take Vs is equal to 0.8 volts. The Vs in the sense voltage across the switch when it is conducting is 0.8 volts. Looks like is on the lower side. Vd is 0.8 volts voltage across the diode, and switching frequency is 2 kilohertz. Looks like all three values are on the lower side. If it is a flatback converter, maybe generally the power rating is of the order of 100 to 150 watts or so, switching frequency is definitely higher than 2 kilohertz. And in that case, voltage across the switch when it is conducting is much higher than 0.8 volts. Anyway, we will take this and we will solve the problem. Okay. What is the condition, or how did you derive the transfer function? We said volt second per turn balance is a must. In other words, at steady state, increase in flux should be equal to the decrease in flux. Okay. So d phi, positive d phi is when I close the switch and it is closed for dt seconds, n is the number of turns in the primary. So voltage across the primary is VDC minus VS. Say in this figure, VDC is the voltage applied to the primary of the winding, 0.8 volts is the drop here, remaining voltage appears across the winding. Okay. And in the secondary, what is the voltage here? Secondary is, this is 100 volts, output is regulated at 100 volts. There is a diode here, so 0.8 volts is a drop across the diode, plus minus. So voltage here is 100.8. This is 100, the voltage drop across the diode, so this will be 100.8. So volt second per turn balance equation is this: N1 into VDC minus VS into T on should be equal to V0 plus VD into T off divided by N2. At nominal input, that V is a 12 volts, V0 is 100 volts at D is equal to 0.5. Okay. So you substitute in this, so you will get N2 by N1 is 9. Okay. Now what is the variation in D that is required when the voltage varies from 10 to 14 volts? Definitely D is higher than 0.5 when the input is less than 12, and D is less than 0.5 when input voltage is higher than 12. So you substitute for T on and T off in terms of D, okay, and solve this equation, you will get the equation for D in terms of supply voltages and the turns ratio. Okay. Now VDC is changing, all the other parameters are constant. What should be the value of D? You just substitute it. You will find that at VDC equal to 12 volts, D is 0.5, see, and input is 10 volts, D has increased to 0.55, and when D is 14 volts, sorry, when VDC is 14 volts, duty cycle is 0.6. Actually, a closed loop controller does this. There is a regulator or a controller which senses the output voltage. If I see, initially the input voltage was 12, D is 0.5, a steady state is attained. Now the input has changed to 10, D is still 0.5, so output voltage starts falling. Immediately controller senses, because this is a continuous process, sensing is a continuous process, and measure the output, compare with the reference, take the corrective action. So reference has been kept at 100 volts, output is falling because input has reduced, so immediately controller takes action, a suitable action. That action is nothing but increasing the value of D, and it will attain a steady state. Okay. Now how do I solve the part B of the problem? The part B of the problem says that what is the value of LS so that I2 is just continuous when D is equal to D minimum. Okay. So the current waveform for the secondary current is looks like this, it's just continuous. Okay. At DT it jumps to the peak value, okay, it starts falling and it becomes 0 at T, and slope of this line is voltage across the secondary winding, which is nothing but V0 plus VD divided by LS. This is the slope of this line, and this is the secondary circuit, a capacitor parallel with the resistor. So at steady state, average value of the current that is flowing through a capacitor should be 0. So I2 average should be equal to average value of the load current. Okay. So average value of the load current is nothing but V0 by R. I am neglecting the ripple in V0. I am neglecting the ripple in V0. Okay. So average value of I2 is nothing but average value of the load current. Average value of the load current is 1 ampere. Now what is the average value of this waveform? From 0 to DT, I2 is 0 and it is a right angle triangle. So what is the average value of this? It is area of this triangle divided by the time period. Okay. So this is the equation. Average I2 should be equal to average I0. So the peak value of the current is given by this equation. Now from this figure, I know the slope, I know this time period, so I can calculate this current, this value. I know the slope, I know this period, I can calculate this current. Okay. So what is the relationship between this duration and the slope of this line? It is this. 1 minus d into t is the time, this is the slope, the peak current. So equate it, equate these two equations, you will get equation for Ls. Okay. V naught is held constant, I2 should be just continuous at d is equal to d minimum. It has been given. So d is 0.46. So Ls comes out to be 612 microhenries. 612 microhenries. Now the last part of the problem. This is output voltage ripple is 1% at d is equal to d max. Previous is current should be just continuous at d is equal to d minimum. Now we will see when the capacitor is charging and when it is discharging. It all depends on the duration for which capacitor is charging and the duration for which capacitor is discharging. Secondary current waveform, the right angle triangle, average value is 1 ampere. And the circuit is this, I2 is the input current coming from the secondary, divides into two parts. Okay. This current is constant. So if I2 is higher than 1 ampere, the difference between I2 minus 1 ampere will flow through the capacitor, and when I2 falls below 1 ampere, capacitor starts discharging. Okay. So we will go back. So above 1 ampere, the current that is flowing to the capacitor. So this duration, capacitor is charging, and the remaining entire duration from 0 to dt and from tc onwards, capacitor is discharging. Okay. Now we need to find out the charge is transferred to the capacitor. Okay. Or first we will find out the time for which the capacitor is charging, or TC. We know the slope because the voltage is V0 plus VD and the inductance is LS. Okay. So I2 is falling at the rate of V0 plus VD divided by LS. Peak value of IC, this current is IP minus I0, okay. I0 is 1 ampere. So TC is peak value of this current divided by the slope of this line. Okay. So del Q or the charge that is transferred to the capacitor, that nothing but C dV naught by dt is equal to this, the area of this triangle. Okay. That is nothing but half of IP minus I naught, that is peak, into TC. Now value of TC is again given by this equation. Okay. Now you substitute it, you will get equation for tel q. Now I naught is V naught by R, Ip is 2 V naught divided by R 1 minus 3. This equation we have already solved in part B. Okay. So you substitute here, you will get delta Q is equal to this term. Okay. So this is nothing but C delta V naught, okay. And percentage voltage ripple is nothing but delta V naught divided by V naught. Okay. So C delta V naught is this. So delta V naught by V naught is this equation. Same. C is here, V square was here, so comes here, so V naught. Remaining terms the same. Now this is 1%, it is given, value of D is also known, so C is found to be 36 microfarads. Okay. This is about the problem on flyback converter. We will solve another problem on forward converter. Okay. The problem says, a forward converter is operating at the boundary of continuous and discontinuous conduction. Switching frequency is 100 kilohertz. A realistic figure, 100 kilohertz. Okay, another ideal feature, assume mu is equal to infinity so that energy recovery winding is ignored. Okay. So we have just two windings. And it is said that 1 is to 1. Okay. It does not matter, it does not matter, because 50 and 20, so voltage ratios are not, or voltages are not greatly different, but then problem says, okay, they have used the forward converter, it is fine. Okay. Maybe just provides isolation between input and output. Okay. A load of 10 amperes at 20 volts is being supplied. Okay, 10 amperes at 20 volts is being supplied. Determine the value of L and peak to peak ripple in the output voltage. In the previous problem, we had to find out C to limit the ripple of ripple to 1%. Here we need to find out the peak to peak voltage ripple, and C is 100 microfarads. It is given. How do I solve the problem? I think we need to ignore all the device drops. Okay. We can take into account, it is not a problem. Now, voltage across the inductor when the switch is on is how much? Is the voltage induced here in this winding minus V naught. Okay. That is the voltage across the inductor. Diode is conducting when the switch is on. So voltage induced in the secondary is VDC into N2 divided by N1. Now it so happens that N1 is equal to N2. So voltage induced here is 50 volts itself. This is 20. So when the switch is on, voltage across the inductor is 30 volts. And when the switch is off, DF starts conducting because IL should be continuous. So voltage across inductor is 20 volts. See, mu is infinity, so magnetizing current is 0, so you do not require a tertiary winding, some sort of an ideal case. So this is the voltage waveform across the inductor, equate it. So you will get a transfer function VDC into N2 divided by N1 into D. Again, we have ignored the device drops. You can take those. If they are given, you can take into account and you will get another equation. So D is 0.4. So therefore, T on this period is 4 microsecond, T off is 6 microseconds. Okay. Yeah, by the way, problem says that forward converter is operating at the boundary of continuous and discontinuous conduction. Part B says assume mu is equal to infinity, so the energy recovery winding is ignored. Now please do not get confused. I had told that for forward and flyback, if I say discontinuous conduction, it implies that flux in the core is discontinuous. Okay? Load current for a flyback is nothing but a voltage source there. Okay, it is continuous. And here in a forward converter, I have approximately a current source. So I can safely assume that load current is continuous. But in this problem, they have said that mu is equal to infinity, so therefore neglect the recovery winding or third winding. So the question of taking IM into account doesn't exist. Please, let's try to understand. It is mentioned that energy recovery winding is ignored. Okay? So there is no third winding, therefore current, the continuity of current in third winding doesn't exist here. So when it is said that forward converter is operating at the boundary of continuous and discontinuous, here we need to assume that this current is nothing but the current flowing through the inductor L. Inductor L. Okay. So IL starts from 0, increases just prior to closing the switch, it attains a peak and again it comes down. Average value of this current is 10 amperes. It is given. Okay. Now, what is the peak value of the IL? What is the peak value of IL? Because to plot IC, current that is flowing through the capacitor, and to determine the voltage ripple, I need to know the current that is flowing through the capacitor. Okay, this. So when IL is less than the average value of the load current, capacitor is discharging. Okay, and it, when it is, when the inductor current is higher than the 10 amperes, capacitor is charging. Okay, so what is this peak value? Peak value is nothing but area divided by area of this, the whole triangle divided by the time. So you will find that this peak is 20 amperes. Okay, this peak is 20 amperes. Now what is the value of the inductor L? Current reaches peak in 4 microseconds. Voltage that is applied across the inductor is 30 volts. Okay? Therefore, L is 6 microhenries. I'll repeat. This dt is 4 microseconds. Voltage applied to the winding is, voltage applied across the inductor is 30 volts. Okay? And this is the variation of current. So L is 6 microhenries. 6 microhenries. And the same procedure to determine the output voltage ripple. C dV naught by dt should be equal to dq is equal to half, see, area of this triangle. This is dt by 2 because entire dt is 4. This is linear. So this is, this point is dt by 2, dt by 2, or midpoint in between 0 to dt. And this is the midpoint between dt and t. Okay. So for 5 microsecond capacitor is charging. The peak value is 10 amperes. This is 10 amperes because peak of IL is 20. So this is 10 amperes. So area of this triangle, okay, 10 into 5 is 25 microcoulombs. So del V is 25 microcoulomb divided by 100 microfarads is 0.25 volts. So voltage ripple is so of the order of or is equal to 1.25%. So that is the reason we neglect the change in the average value of the load current, because see the voltage ripple itself is of the order of 1.25%, 1.25%. In other words, the voltage change in output voltage is 0.25 volts at average value of 20. For an engineer, it is constant. So that is the reason we always assume that I naught, the load current is assumed to be constant, okay. Though we change the, we plot the variation of the capacitor voltage, okay, and we assume that output current remains constant. Somehow there is a contradiction there, but then see this problem clearly says change in the output voltage is 0.25 volts, average is 20. So change in the load current, average value of the load current is approximately 0, okay. So that is about the flyback as well as the forward converter. In both the cases, we are using a transformer, okay. In one case, source supplies only the magnetizing current in the flyback converter, whereas in a forward converter, source supplies the magnetizing as well as the equivalent load current. But then, in both cases, operation is always in the first quadrant, okay. Now let us see the operation in both the quadrants, okay. I had told you that flyback converter is very attractive if the power rating of the power supply is of the order of 100 to 150 watts, okay. And maybe from 100 to 500 watt or 600 watts forward converter is preferred. Now, for high power range, what sort of a power supply to choose now? Definitely, we need to use bidirectional core excitation. See, in flyback and forward, it is a unidirectional core excitation. Current in the core is DC. Please, DC doesn't mean that constant value of DC. Okay, average value is finite. Okay. Now, bidirectional core excitation is nothing but AC excitation to the transformer. Okay. Now, again, AC need not be a sinusoidal. AC implies average value is 0. That's all. So, current that is flowing to the transformer should be AC now. Input is DC, okay. Now how do I do this? So what I will do is I will use two forward converters, okay, and connect them in antiphase, okay. I will draw the figure and I will show you. So one forward converter is pushing the power, or it is working in the first quadrant, positive NI. Another forward converter is negative NI. So I am applying both positive core excitation as well as a negative core excitation. That's why I am calling, I am saying that current that is flowing through a transformer is AC. Okay, it is AC because average value is 0. That's all. So definitely for high power high power applications, I need to use bidirectional core excitation. That I can achieve, one of the ways to achieve is to use two forward converters working in antiphase. Okay? So both the converters are pushing the power to the load. In one converter is working in when NI is positive, or in when I am working the first quadrant, the forward converter supplies power to the load, and even when I applied negative NI, okay, forward converter still supplies power to the load. In other words, both are pushing power to the output. So the obvious name should have been a push-push converter. Okay? I do not know. The name that is prevailed is push-pull converter. Okay? I do not know why it is push-pull converter. Here, both the converters are pushing power to the load. It should have been push-push converter. But push-pull converter has prevailed. Okay? Let's see how does it work. It's a bit difficult. Try to understand. Okay? A bit difficult. Here is a push-pull converter. I said is a AC excitation. So therefore, voltage induced in the secondary is AC. Again, I'm not saying that is a sinusoid. Okay? So I want a DC power supply. Okay. So voltage induced in the winding is AC, because AC excitation or bidirectional core excitation. I want a DC power supply. Definitely you need to have one more stage which converts AC to DC, or you can use either a bridge rectifier or a center tap version of the full wave rectifier using two diodes. Okay, so I am using two diodes. So this is the secondary side of the push pull converter. A center tap winding, see the dotted polarities, number of turns in both the winding the same. See these two, D1 and D2 are the diodes, and this is the output stage. Looks like a forward converter, isn't it? This is nothing but a forward converter stage or a buck converter stage. And I said two forward converters working antiphase. So definitely transfer function should be same as that of a forward converter with some other multiplying factor. Okay. And seeing the primary, I have again a two winding, a center tapped transformer, N11, N12, okay. N11 is equal to N12, a VDC power supply, and two switches. I need to use two switches. Okay. So how does this circuit work? How does this circuit work? From 0 to DT by 2, see here. All this time I said 0 to DT switch is on. It's fine, but then here there are two switches. Okay. So from 0 to DT by 2, T1 is turned on and T2 should be off. I'll repeat, from 0 to DT by 2, T1 is on and T2 should be off. Okay, why, we'll see later. From DT by 2 to T by 2, that is half the cycle is over here, T by 2, T1 and T2 are off. Both the switches are off. Now, I'm not going to tell you what happens in the secondary. Sometime later I'll tell you. Okay, it's not very obvious. Okay. So whatever that happened from 0 to T by 2, for T1, it will happen from t by 2 to t for t 2. Okay. So, from t by 2 to 1 plus d into t by 2, t 2 is on and t 1 is off, and from 1 plus d into t by 2 to t is equal to t, t 1 and t 2 are off. Okay. So, both the switches are off. I have not told anything about the secondary. Okay. Fine. We will see now. From t to t is equal to 0 to t is equal to dt by 2, t 1 is on. Okay. See this equivalent circuit. In the primary side, current enters the dot in N11 turns. Okay. Current enters the dot. So, in the secondary, if you see, current should leave the dot. Okay. Yes, D1 can conduct now because current ID1. Okay. So, D1 is on, D2 is off. Okay. So, voltage applied to N11 is VDC with the dot as positive. Okay. Voltage induced in N12 is again VDC because number of turns is the same. Okay, with the dot as positive. Therefore, voltage across the switch T2, how much is that? It is VDC, see, minus is connected to positive of the voltage induced in N12 or V12. Okay, positive, positive voltage. So, V12. So, it is nothing but 2 VDC. Voltage across the switch is twice the supply voltage. Remember. Okay. So, T2 should block twice the input voltage. Current enters the dot here, I1 is, okay, I will not talk about I1. Current enters the dot, current leaves the dot, ID1 starts increasing because ID1 is same as IL, same as IL. Okay. Voltage induced in N21 is VDC into N21 divided by N11. Okay. Or N2 by 2 divided by N1 by 2 because number of turns in N21 is half of the total number of turns and here also. So, I can write V21 voltage induced in N21 is nothing but VDC into N2 divided by N1. Actually, it is N21 divided by N11. So, N11 is nothing but N1 by 2. And N21 is nothing but N2 by 2. Okay. So, voltage induced in N21 is same as voltage induced in N22 turns. Diode D2 is off. Okay. So, voltage across the diode D2 is twice VDC into N2 divided by N1. Is sum of these two voltage sources, sum of these two voltage sources, because D1 is conducting, this point is gets connected here. So, voltage across D2 is 2 VDC into N2 divided by N1. IL starts increasing slowly. Okay. Primary winding of the transformer, it has to provide the magnetizing current, which again increases linearly. Okay. And I1 should have the equivalent secondary load current. Okay. I said I1 also increases linearly, Im also increases linearly, but then the rate of increase of IL is not the same as rate of increase of Im. Im, rate of increase of Im depends on the magnetizing inductance of the transformer. Okay. Whereas rate of increase of VL, sorry, rate of increase of the inductor current IL depends on voltage across the inductor and the value of L. Okay. So they increase linearly, but then rates are not the same, right? Not the same. So see here, therefore I1 is the load current. This IL is flowing in N21, okay. This N21 is nothing but N2 by 2, but whereas I1 is flowing in N11, and N11 is nothing but N1 by 2. So I1 is equal to IL into N2 divided by N1 plus the magnetizing current. Im increases linearly, okay. Now at dt by 2, switch is turned off. What happens? What happens in the circuit? When the switch is turned off, magnetizing current should be continuous and the inductor current IL should be continuous. Okay. Now in the forward converter there was a diode, okay, which is providing a path for IL, and we used a tertiary winding for continuity of flux. Okay, magnetizing current starts flowing in the tertiary winding. But if you see in this figure, N22 is similar to the energy recovery winding of the flyback converter. See, current is entering the dot here. So any coil wherein current can enter when the switch is turned off can provide a path for the flux. I'll repeat. Current was entering the dot when I closed the switch in the primary. So when I open the switch, current should enter the dot in some other winding which is mutually coupled with the primary one. Okay. Now if you see in this figure, current in N22 can enter, I2 enters the dot. Okay. Here T2 is not closed, we have not closed T2. So I1 or the magnetizing current can enter N2 or this coil, or can enter this coil because of this diode. Okay, and it can flow through this path. So IL also can flow through this path. Okay, I said can. What happens, I'll tell you later. Okay. So I can say that N11 and N21, they form a forward converter. Okay. And N11 and N22 are similar to a flyback, or N22 is similar to a energy recovery winding. Now here it is feeding power back to this load, this energy recovery winding feeding power to the same load looks like, and continuity of IL also can be provided by the same circuit. But then if you see this circuit very carefully, N21 and N22 are also mutually coupled. I'll repeat, N21 and N22 are mutually coupled. current in N2 is entering the dot. I'll repeat, current in N22 is entering the dot. So the right direction for the current in N21 is to leave the dot, and it is possible. See, we have a very interesting case here. When switch is closed, current enters the dot in the primary, current can leave the dot in the secondary. That can happen only in the upper half, or it can happen only in N21 coil because of D1. So no current in N22 because of D2. Okay. So when I open the switch, if there is a coil wherein current can enter the dot, this will provide a path for the magnetizing current or the continuity of flux, which is possible here is N22 coil. Current can enter the dot because of D2. But then if current enters the dot in N22, current in N21 will try to leave the dot, and it is possible because diode is connected that way. So in this circuit, just see here, if current tries to enter this dot here, current can leave the dot here, and there is a path. There is a path. So therefore, when I open the switch, both D1 and D2 starts conducting. Both D1 and D2 starts conducting. Let's see how they share the inductor current sometime in our next lecture. Thank you.